find the wrong way, won't you? Open your mouth and say hallelujah.
An old song that says, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, where would I be? Where would I be?
My Lord.
I'm thankful today for the Lord being on my side.
Yes,
and if I need to rephrase it, I'm thankful for the Lord allowing me to be on his side. Well, there's nothing special about my side, but there's something great about his. So I'm thankful for the Lord allowing me to be on his side.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Reminds me of the old song I used to hear, Provide was growing up. Is it, whose side are you
leaning on?
Lord. I'm leaning on the Lord's side. Nothing to do with my side. It's all about his. But I'm thankful.
Thank you, Lord.
For this opportunity for these opportunities aren't guaranteed.
Yeah.
I'm thankful he's blessed me with one more opportunity to stand.
Thank you, Lord.
In the gap. So if you have your Bibles with you, please follow me to the Epistle of 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter, and we'll begin reading the 16th verse. And that's 2 Corinthians 4 and 16.
Amen.
Once you arrive, give me an amen.
Amen.
If you need more time, just say, hold on.
Hold on. Amen.
2 Corinthians 4 and 16. And we find these words recorded. And listen to the word of the Lord. Scripture records, therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal.
Yeah.
Just for a moment, I want to leave with you how to focus on what's unseen.
Alright.
How to focus on what's unseen.
Alright.
Inspire us with a prayer. Father, I thank you, Lord, I thank you for this day and this hour. Right now, I ask that you allow me to move out of the way. So, Lord, you can step up and take hold and bring the message that your people are in need of.
Oh, yes.
So, Lord, right now, I ask that the meditations of the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable unto your sight. Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
How to focus on what's unseen. Focus is a very key term in this message. For focus is something that isn't always easily obtained. Well, for focus is something that, depending upon how our physical makeup is made upon, some of us have sometimes a difficult time focusing.
All right.
You see, sometimes when it's time to focus, our minds begin to wander.
Oh, yeah.
Sometimes when it's time to focus, we let outside distractions limit us from our focus.
All right.
But if we look through through life, we see different opportunities, we see different circumstances where it seems hard to focus. And if it's hard to focus on what seems, the question is, how do we focus on that which is unseen?
Come on now, Jesus.
I know some of you may say, I don't have any problem focusing. Where if I take a look back and I examine everybody wearing glasses. Some of you may even be wearing contacts.
Come on now.
You see, there's a purpose behind this.
All right.
For some of you may be nearsighted, some of you may be farsighted. Some of you might have a stigmatism. Or whatever it may be, but for some reason, if you remove those glasses,
come on here.
Certain things will be hard to focus.
Hey.
Amen.
All right.
You see, focus is something that sometimes easily overlooked.
All right.
For I remember the first time when I realized that my sugar levels were getting high, everything began to go out of focus.
All right.
Well, and I asked my wife, so what's going on? For some reason, I normally have 20/20 vision, but things are just a little blurry, or I'm not able to focus.
All right.
That's when I went to the doctor and I found out that there was an outside thing happening in my body that is causing me to lose.
All right.
Even reminds me of college sports. Oftentimes, the team that's losing has the tendency to lose focus.
All right. Mm-hmm.
For before they walk into a game, each coach gives them a game plan. Before they walk into the game, each coach gives them a responsibility.
Uh-huh.
But oftentimes, there are things that happen that cause certain players to lose focus. Uh-huh. And when they lose focus, or when they forget to do their responsibility, that's when they give up a big play.
All right.
Well,
amen.
You see, watching the South Carolina game last night, I saw a lot of people out of focus. But whenever we lose
focus,
that's when things begin to break down.
Jesus.
Oftentimes, if you talk to the coach, he says what happened is fatigue set in, and then they begin to lose focus. And when they begin to lose focus, the defense begin to break down.
All
and
right.
When the defense broke down, that's when the other team begin to score.
Oh yes.
Focus is very important.
Oh yes.
Uh-huh. But all of these things are things that are physically, outwardly able to focus on. But the question at hand is not how do we focus on the words on the page. Because
uh-huh.
If I ask you, that someone would say, I can just use my glasses. It's not how do I focus on the road while I'm driving, because then some of you would say, I just need to have the adequate amount of sleep. It's not how do you focus on your homework, because some of you would say, well, all it takes is for me to realize that it has to be done and I get it done. It's not how do you focus on the news, because if I ask you, how do you focus on the news, some of you would say, I watch CNN, I watch MSNBC, maybe some of you may say, I watch Fox News. Who knows? But those things can easily have an answer for how you focus
all right.
on those things.
Okay.
But when we ask the question, how do we focus on that which is unseen?
Come on in.
Well, that's when we then begin to have questions.
Uh-huh.
That's when we begin to ask ourselves, what do I need to do? For in this race that we call the Christian race, in this thing that we call being a Christian. There are so many things that we have to focus on that is unseen.
All right.
And not just focusing on the thing that's unseen. For what if it was quiet, then it would have been easier to focus.
Mm-hmm.
Because right now, I want you to do me a favor.
Yeah.
Come on.
All right. I want you to close your eyes. Now, I want you to fall asleep on me. So that's a little bit for a while. So close your eyes.
Amen.
And as you close your eyes, I just want you to focus. Focus on how good God has been. Focus on how you hold yours. Hold in your right mind. Open your eyes. It was not that difficult to focus because there was no outside noise.
Come on.
Mm-hmm. That's just the Irish. I want you to get on the keyboard and I want you to get on with the drum for what's that, Brother Chris. And I want you to play something, but I don't want something that's slow and soft. I want something that's fast moving and something that's kind of harsh.
One is perplexed when one sees no way out.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yes.
So not only is there pressure or affliction on the inside and the outside, but in the midst of all that you see no way out.
Come on in.
Yes.
Come on in.
That being said, but Paul now goes, but not in despair. Mm. Despair means utter loss. So even though Paul saw no way out of the situation, even though he had pressure on each side, he was not in despair or didn't see that everything was lost. He said persecuted. The picture behind the word persecuted is persecuted by someone determined to harm someone else. Next we have, but not abandoned. Even though all of these trials was Paul was facing, God had never left him.
Oh, man.
Now see, you need to understand this picture. You are being pressed internally and externally. You can't see a way out of all this, but through all that, you know how tough everything is, but you're still on crush.
Come on in.
You know how tough everything is, but you realize that even though I'm being pressed inside and outwardly, God is still there. Next he says, struck down. When Paul refers to struck down, he is literally referring to being in a crowd in Lystra and left for dead. And this was in Acts 14 and 19. For what happened is Paul was stoned and left to die. So Paul was saying, even though I was perplexed, even though things were pressing inside and outside, and even though I was physically trying to be stoned to death and left to die. He says, but the last thing he says, but not destroyed. This means that Paul was not killed. The Lord spared Paul's life so that he may continue to preach the good news and to testify to the deliverance of God. So even though our trials are pressing us internally and externally, we are not crushed. Even though we don't see any way out of our situation, we don't seem to be lost.
Come on.
Even though we are being persecuted for the sake of the gospel in this world, we have not been abandoned by the Lord. And even though we may have been physically struck down, God has spared our lives and not allowed us to be destroyed.
Yes.
Paul goes on to say that we endure all this because one day, the one who raised Christ from the dead will also raise us up and present us with him in his presence.
Thank you, Lord.
Now this leads us to our foundation text in verse 16, which says, therefore, after all that we just said, therefore, after understanding that I've been beaten, I've been pressed to death, I've been persecuted internally and externally, I don't even see a way out.
Come on here.
Therefore, we do not lose heart.
Come on here.
Even though things may be rough and you don't see a way out and you don't know how you're going to go on, he said, therefore, don't lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, Paul says that the trials and tribulations that he was facing for the sake of the gospel has caused him to begin to physically waste away.
Come on in.
He said, yet inwardly we are being renewed day.
Thank you, Lord.
So the first thing we need to understand on how to focus on that which is unseen is no matter what we're going through, no matter how tough life may seem, no matter what curveballs life throws our way, no matter how we feel about the person beside us, the person behind us, or the person on the phone, we must not lose. We must not lose heart. When we talk about the word heart, I'm not referring to that which beats inside the chest, but as the courage to carry on.
In
sports, someone is considered to have heart when they perform in a way that's not expected for a person of their physical stature. For example, a football player named Ronnie Lott was in the playoff game and partially tore off
of one of his fingers. He had to make a choice between leave the game and go and get the finger fixed or cut the finger off and stay in the game. He chose to cut off the finger and stay in the game. That is considered as a person with heart.
All right.
Whenever you're talking about not losing heart, for one thing, the word is parallel to is courage. And then when you talk about courage, courage isn't not being afraid, but courage is that having the audacity to keep pressing on even through the fear that is possessed there in your life. What I'm trying to tell you today is that you are going to go through situations that you may be afraid, that you may be feel like you're being torn down, and you feel like you can't focus on anything. But what I come to tell you today, there is something there that is unseen, that through your eyes you can't see right now. But if you don't lose heart in that in which God has called us to be, everything can be all right. You see, this is a very important principle. With the proper focus on our future with Christ, He will give us the power to endure any type of trouble. We need to realize that day by day, these temporary vessels, this mortal flesh, this earthly house, is perishing day by day. And has no renewal. I don't care what the plastic surgeon tells you. There's no renewal. I don't care what the skin science say that if you rub this by your eyes, the crow's feet will go away.
Come on, Pastor.
I come to tell you there is no renewal. This body. That's why the older we get, the more things that stayed up, not pulled down. That's why the older that we get, the skin was once firm, now begins to drop. Why? Because we are wasting away. You see, but the earthly house is perishing day by day with no renewal, but the inward man is renewed on a daily basis. Although the external is degrading and dying, the internal does not lose heart, but it is renewed. It is regenerated. It is revitalized. What I'm saying is, what we need to understand is that in the same way that a baby is born, and the skin is soft as can be, and everything is as beautiful as can be, because it's a brand new child, realize that our soul can be reborn. And allow God to have His way in our life, and begin to stop focusing on the things that we can see, and focus on that which is unseen. But when we focus on that which is unseen, and we don't lose heart, it allows us to have an inward renewal every day. Not worrying about what's going to happen tomorrow to dictate how we feel on tomorrow. But realizing no matter what happens tomorrow, God is going to renew me again, so it doesn't matter what happens. Not because of anything that I've done, but because of He who dwells on me. But how do we focus on what we can't see? Now that our heart is in the right place.
Your name.
And I say our heart is in the right place. And I'm going to pause there just for a second, even though I wasn't planning on pausing. The problem with a lot of us is that we need a heart transplant.
All right.
Talk about it. Hey, right there.
We need a heart transplant because we allow feelings. We allow emotions to dictate what we do. We allow, if somebody didn't speak to me right, I ain't going to do X, Y, Z. If somebody recognize me for what I did. Then I'm not going to do X, why.
Jesus.
And if you ain't doing it the way I want it done.
Look out, look out, look out.
Then I ain't gonna come.
Jesus.
If you don't spend the money the way I want it spent, then I ain't gonna pay. We need a heart transplant to realize that it ain't about what I want. When we are worried about what we want is when the world can then push us wherever the world wants us to go. But I'm going to keep on going. But it says, so now that our heart is in the right place. Verse 17, it says, for our light and momentary trouble are achieving from us an eternal glory. Therefore,
thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you.
Again, realize this is the same person who said that he was beaten, stoned to death, tried to be stoned to death for the sake of the Lord. This same person was thrown in jail just for doing what God had called him to do.
All right, man.
Realize this, and this same person calls that light and momentary.
Jesus.
Almost stoned to death.
Yes, sir.
Light and momentary.
God.
Thrown in jail.
Yeah.
For something you didn't do. Light and momentary. How many of us could go through that which Paul went through and call that light and momentary? So what does that mean? In order to focus on that which is unseen, we must have a proper perspective.
All right.
In order to focus on that which is unseen, we must have a proper perspective. Seeing in the perspective of eternity, Christian difficulties, wherever they may be, diminish in importance. When we weigh out the affliction with the glory, the glory outweighs the affliction.
Thank you, Lord.
In this text, Paul focuses on the future, allows him to access problems properly, so we see how small they are compared to the eternal results.
Oh, yes.
Well, for the songwriter Paul Jones wrote a song that spoke to the heart of this verse, which, and the song is entitled, I Won't Complain. And the section of the song says, all of my good days outweigh my bad days, so I won't complain.
All right.
This song, whenever I hear it, helps me to regain my focus on that which is important. We have to understand that in order for us to focus on God, we must have that proper perspective. The problem that we have is our perspective is tainted. Our perspective is dictated on what happens to the person beside us. Our perspective is often dictated on the ones who aren't doing right and the successes that they are having. That's why the songwriter, I really believe, penned that song farther along, will know all about it. Because in the songs that tempted and tried, you're often made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long. And he said, while there are others that are living all about us, they're never molested, they're never bothered, even though they seem to be in the wrong.
But
the proper perspective says, farther along, we'll know all about it. What we need to understand is we need to realize that everything that we go through on this earth is a purpose in our lives for the upbuilding of us. And don't worry about what somebody else is going through. Just look at what I'm going through and ask God, where are you using my troubles to take me? And then you realize, Lord, I'm going through trouble right now, but this trouble's only for a little time. Because then one day, all my troubles will be gone. Because then you can say, one day, because I'm going where the wicked shall cease from.
Oh, yeah.
And the weary.
They won't be no more.
Shall be at rest.
Jesus.
And all of the saints of the ages.
Oh, yes.
Will sit at his feet. And be blessed.
Jesus.
What we need to understand is that eternity is a lot longer than what we're dealing with right now. So the question is, do we want to cause a fuss over something that's just small, or do we want to prepare for eternity?
Yes.
The question is, are we going to live a life worrying and fussing and grumpy about what somebody did to me rather than worry about what I can do for the Lord? Are we going to sit and worry about what everybody else is doing, gonna do, when they gonna do, instead of just wondering, God, what can I do?
Jesus.
Or when we gain the proper
perspective. Oh, yes.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Yes, sir.
When we gain the proper perspective.
Oh, yes.
Yes, sir.
We can be like Paul.
Yeah.
Yeah, see, Paul was mentally and physically beaten.
Jesus. Mm.
And through all that, he had a mind to realize, this is tough.
Yeah.
But guess what? I'm so glad.
Oh, Jesus.
Trouble don't last always.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You see, I like the point that there's one good thing about a storm.
Yeah.
See, storms are always temporary.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
No matter how long a storm may be, the storm is always temporary.
Jesus.
No matter how rough that storm may be,
well,
that storm is always temporary.
Yeah.
No matter how long it rains. In the Bible, it rained for 40 days and 40 nights,
oh, yeah,
and it flooded the entire earth. But guess what? On that 40th day, it says the rain stopped.
All right.
Do you know why? Because even that storm was temporary.
Jesus.
That's the thing we need to understand, is that the storms in our lives,
oh, yeah,
are only temporary.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes. Even the storms that lead to death, because
Jesus,
realize that to be absent from the body is to be present.
Somebody.
Oh, yeah.
What we need to understand is we have to gain the proper
perspective.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Now that we have a proper perspective,
yeah,
verse 18 declares, so we fix our eyes on what is unseen.
Uh-huh.
You see, after we've had our heart transplant, after we understand that these trials and these troubles don't allow us to lose heart.
All right.
Once we're able to look at our situation and place it into the proper perspective of eternity, then he says, once you've done that, because until you do that, it is hard to do what's in verse 18.
Yeah.
You see, until you get through verse 16 and 17, you can't do what's in verse 18.
All right.
Come on, wait.
Say it one more time.
Yeah.
Until you can digest what's in verse 16 and 18, in 17, you can't get to 18. The problem is, oftentimes, we try to skip over 16 and 17 and focus on 18, and when troubles come, we begin to lose focus. So 18 says, so we fix our eyes, not on what's seen, not on the diagnosis of the doctor.
Jesus!
Not on the amount of zeros that we have in our bank account.
All right.
Not on the position that we hold or the recognition.
Come on in.
But it says, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary. But what's unseen is eternal.
Yeah.
I want you to look around. Everything that you see.
Yeah.
See all your beautiful family and friends.
Mm-hmm.
See the beautiful church building.
All right.
See the nice carpet. See the lights and the power that we have.
all of this is temporary.
Temporary.
I'm temporary.
Come on.
For one day.
One day.
When this life is over.
Jesus.
I'm gonna fly away.
Angel Lord.
Oh, yes.
This building is temporary.
Come on.
Because one day the next Hurricane Hugo may come through and knock the whole thing down.
Jesus. Temporary.
Our position of temporary.
Temporary, yes.
So he is telling us the things that we see, why are we focusing on those? Before we close this thing out.
Come on now.
Why are we focusing on these carnal things that our eyes can see? Because we are imperfect person living in an imperfect world, but we are expecting perfect results. We are an imperfect people.
All right.
Living in an imperfect world, expecting perfect results. And when the results aren't to our liking, we rebel.
Yes. Jesus.
When the doctor don't say what you want to do, what do you do? Yeah. You get a second opinion.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
When the bank ain't charging you too many fees, what do? You find another bank.
Hello.
Or even when the church ain't going the way you want
it
to go.
Yeah.
Watch out. You find another church. We are imperfect ourselves.
All right.
And something that's imperfect, we try to do
that. Come on, yeah.
But the scripture says, but we can't focus on those things which we see.
No.
Yeah.
But on that which is unseen, for that what is unseen is eternal.
Jesus.
So the last thing I'm going to leave with you before I take my seat is you need to fix your eyes on Jesus.
All right. Yes,
the experiences and the circumstances of this present life, often painful and even perplexing, are what is visible to us as Christians. But these are merely a season in our lives, and therefore they are temporary.
All right.
To fix our eyes on these things would cause us to lose heart. To fix our eyes on these things will cause us to lose our focus.
Come on in.
But by contrast, the unseen realities, which are no less real for them being invisible, are eternal and imperishable. So the question that I asked in the beginning of the message is how to focus on that which is unseen.
Come on in.
And the main thing behind all that is we have to focus on Jesus.
All right.
You need to fix your eyes on Jesus.
Oh, yeah.
Because as the old song says, hold on to God's unchanging hand.
Oh, yeah.
See, as you go through life, people are going to change.
Oh, yeah.
Our outward appearances, whether we like it or not,
it's
going to change.
All right.
You see, I wish my hairline didn't change over the past 20 years, but guess what? It did. I wish my stomach didn't change
over
the last 14 years, but guess what? It did.
All right.
The things that I see are going to continue to change.
Yeah.
And if I place my hope,
Jesus.
If I place my joy on those things that I can see, if I just look at my stomach now and think about where it was back then, I would get depressed. If I look at my hairline now and look at the picture when I got married, and if that's where my joy came from, I would be depressed.
Yes.
But let me tell you, if I look at Jesus,
yes,
that's when I first got saved.
Yes.
sweeter as the day go by. What I come to tell you is that when I walk with him and he talks to me and he tells me, I realized that even when I was down, I was still his own. Even when I was up, I was still his own. Even when my hair was falling in my eyes, I was still a child of God. Even when I don't have nothing on top, I'm going to still be a child of God. And as long as I focus on being a child of God, nothing that happens in this world can allow me to falter. Nothing that happens in this world can change my mindset to what God has called me to do.
Thank you.
But how to focus on what's
unseen.
First, we must have a heart transplant and realize we can't lose heart. Church, no matter how tough life may get, no matter what trials you go through, your family goes through, you can't lose heart and do
Yes.
Secondly, we have to have a proper perspective.
Yeah.
We must realize that when compared to eternity, nothing that we have that can happen in our life is only minuscule.
Yeah.
It's only temporary.
Yeah.
The moment that we understand and take that into focus, the moment life becomes easy. When your pains that you go through, you can say, well, pain, you better have your way with me now because it's only temporary. When you can speak to your storm and say, storm, you better do your worst because this is only for a little while. But when I get to heaven, you can't rage against the Lord. When we gain the proper perspective, and then once all that is done and we just fix our eyes on Jesus, then we can focus on that which is unseen.
Jesus.
But in order to get there, you got to realize Paul wasn't talking to the unsaved. He was talking to the saved. All right. You see, oftentimes we like to look at certain texts, certain things, and say he was talking to the unsaved. He wasn't talking to me. But I come to tell you, he was talking to you.
Yeah.
He was talking to me.
Yeah.
Letting us know that life is going to come.
Oh, yeah.
And it's going to come strong.
Yes.
And the closer you get to God, the stronger it's going to come.
Amen.
Amen. But all that being said, we have to hold on to the hand of the Lord. But it is impossible to hold on to something you don't know what it is. If you don't know the hand of the Lord, it can be standing right there in front of you. You don't know what it is. So as we stand in the quiet seat, I ain't gonna hold you no longer. How many of you are willing to hold on to God when you see your hand? How many of you are willing to let go of all the petty carnal things of this world that so easily trouble us, that so easy allow our actions, allow our faith, allow our works to waver? How many of you are willing to let all those things go and says, God, here I am.
That's right.
And say, Lord, I realize that I'm not serving for the people beside me.
That's right.
But I'm serving for you.
Yeah.
How many of you can push aside all the waiver that's what the scripture says? When that happens, life will change.
Yes, sir.
When that happens, when people
should call me,
look at your situation,
would I be ready?
Begin to laugh, even shout. hurt. You can't allow any things to dictate your service to the Lord. That said that I gotta remove this hardened heart, have a heart transplanted by the Lord. Now and forevermore, let us all say,
Amen.